Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the first presentation of this event. My name is Štěpán Sršeň and I will speak about applied statistics and in computational spectroscopy. I'm a PhD student in the theoretical photodynamics research group, which is led by Professor Petr Slavíček. Our main research is focused on the interaction of light with molecules. We also develop new computational methods, which we apply in various fields of chemistry. But today I want to talk about a new branch of my research. Imagine you are interested in some molecular property. How would you obtain it? Well, we know from quantum theory that the system is fully defined by its wave function. So we can just solve the Schrödinger equation, right? But the problem is that the computational demands of solving the Schrödinger equation grows with the number of particles exponentially. So we have to use some approximations. But even approximative methods are too computational demanding if you want quantitative results. So how do we overcome these limitations? Well, we can use more approximative methods and settle with qualitative results. Or we can buy bigger machines, but I get a doctoral scholarship, I can't afford this. Other way is to wait, because according to Moore's law, we are going to have much powerful machines in few years, but will your research still be innovative? I chose another way. I know, if I say apply statistics, it sounds boring, doesn't it? But if I say machine learning or artificial intelligence, one can imagine something much more exciting, right? But don't be mistaken, these are just areas of applied statistics. When we want to solve Schrödinger equation, the only thing we need to know is the Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian is dependent only on atomic positions and their charges. So this is the only input we need to know. But now, we can, instead of solving Schrödinger equation, we can look for this mapping directly by machine learning. This task is called regression. We are looking for a function which maps input X, in our case some is basically molecular structure, to output Y, which is the molecular property we want to know. How do we do this? I guess everybody here has already used regression, for example, line fitting. In this case, the function we are looking for is much more complex, but the principle is the same. We need some training data which we use for fitting the parameters of some prescribed function. In the case of line fitting, there will be only two parameters, the slope and the shift of the line. In our case, what does the function look like? Well, there are some options. Everybody heard of neural networks. It's basically just a fitting of a complex function which consists of simple functions called neurons. Each neuron consists is basically a transformed linear combination of its predecessors. Other possibilities are kernel methods, which are basically methods for linear regression, but they transform input data in a clever way so that they are applicable for nonlinear problems. These approaches were more or less successfully used in different areas of chemistry, but it is important to note that we are not getting rid of quantum chemistry. We are just augmenting it with machine learning because the physics is still there. It's encoded in the training data. We can be only as precise as the training data. We can often get to chemical accuracy, which is 1 kilocalorie per mole. But there are other tasks in machine learning. I will give you some examples where I use machine learning in my research. But you can imagine using it on your own problems. For example, you have some data points, and you want to obtain a distribution it comes from. Well, you can use machine learning. From my point of view, spectrum is nothing else than a probability distribution of absorbing or emitting photon. Other possibility, you want to find some structure in your data. I can use clustering, which is another machine learning technique, to find to identify peaks in spectrum, and then I can model the spectra much more effectively. Or other possibility, you want to, when you're obtaining your data, it can be very time consuming and very computational demanding. But you can use machine learning to reduce the number of points you need. This way, I was able to reduce, let's say, 10 times the number of calculations I have to do, because I use machine learning to identify the representative subset of data so that I needed only to calculate this subset. And of course, one can use, we use the regression I was talking in the first place. Okay, that's all from my presentation. Thank you for your attention, and now it's time for your questions.
One very general question. You speak about statistics and you mentioned machine learning, you mentioned neural networks. How do you see the differences in these times from the point of view? What are more or less some principles? What is some practical application? How to work with these times?
Well, as I said, machine learning is just an area of applied statistics, and neural networks are just a kind of machine learning. Neural networks can be, well, they are suitable for classification or regression, I was talking about. They are more complicated than other machine learning techniques because there has to be some empirical knowledge. It's much more easy to use, for example, those kernel methods I was talking about, because that's just simple formula which you use and you fit these weights. In this case, you have to design the neural network first, and that's a thing which is not easy and it takes a lot of time to do it properly. And if you do so, it will bring you only a slightly better results. Oh, there's somebody else.
What kind of model do you use?
Well, I usually use this one.
Okay.
Because, as I said...
I mean something from practice? Some skill or something like that?
I use these kernel methods in order to estimate excitation energies and transition probabilities of excitations in order to model absorption spectra of, for example, azobenzene or Krieg intermediate. Somebody might know it from organic chemistry.
So some aromatic compounds and alkaline compounds and so on.
Yeah, basically whatever. Whatever you want. Please?
What's the current case?
Well, current case is the azobenzene.
My very short question, probably. For training, do you use experimental data or data created by some other, more or less theoretical approaches?
You can use both, but you need quite a lot of data. What we usually do is that we use some quantum method to generate bunch of data, and we use this data to train the model, and then we use this model to predict properties for new molecules, new geometries, and so.
Thank you. So thank you very much, and I guess there will be time after 3 p.m. just to discuss together the individual topics. Thank you very much once more.